6 months ago, we ended our report from the Lebanon in this cemetery. Then 20,000 people had died in the war. Then this ground was prepared for those who would die. Now the graveyard is full. 6 months on, the death toll in the Lebanon is 40,000. Six months on, the war is worse. At the front line in Beirut, it's become a ritual. There's no advance, no retreat. The money market of the Middle East may be destroyed utterly, but the war in the rubble never stops. Each side watches the other with vigilance, waiting for a shadow, a face, a victim. The fighters are young. On this side, the Lebanese left and the Palestinians, who emerged from refugee camps to support their war against the right. On the other side, 25 yards away. The fighters are at the front 24 hours a day, day in, day out, holding the line until they're dead or wounded, when others will take their place. Six months ago, the alliance of the Lebanese left and the Palestinians had driven the right into a small coastal enclave. Surrender or partition seemed inevitable. At this point, the Syrian army crossed into Lebanon and within a few months had occupied more than half the country. Their purpose, to prevent the collapse of the right. So the left and the Palestinians found themselves confronting Syrian troops on one side and right-wing forces on the other. Then, 2 weeks ago, a major Syrian offensive drove them from key positions in the mountains onto the retreat. It was the Syrians advancing with their tanks and heavy artillery who forced the Palestinians to retreat to this position here. This is now the Palestinian front line. The Syrians control from those houses up on the ridge there, along the top, the trees and the few isolated houses on the corner there, and the ground coming down in front of us. Their nearest position is about 100 yards away. Today, this morning, it's quiet. Last night, there was a lot of shelling here. And the Palestinians are waiting for a Syrian advance at any time. The Syrians are dug into Lebanon like an army of occupation. The Syrians want to have control here, to stop an upheaval which could easily spread across the border and explode in Syria. But their tanks are not here to keep the peace. Their task is to crush the independent power of the Palestinian people. The Palestinians couldn't possibly win. They and the Lebanese left, which supports them, are outnumbered and outgunned. Until yesterday, they waited. Today, the Syrian attack came. Tonight, this is the center of a fierce battle between the Palestinians and the Syrians for control of the town. The Palestinians are defiant, fighting to stop the Syrian advance, to defend their last stronghold in the Middle East. The mines on the roads will slow the onslaught, not stop it. Answering the call to arms, these Palestinians have left their studies in Germany to defend their cause. It's not the battle they relish.
To fight, it's not enjoyment, but to protect your people, that's the enjoyment. I have no the bourgeoisie dream to be an engineer and a car and something like that. I'm studying to build my new country one day. I am Palestinian, but they treat me as a man without nationality, and that's very sad.
Without nationality?
Without nationality, yeah. And they like to say, the people there like to say it for us, without nationality. I told them I'm Palestinian. Okay, where is Palestine?
in Germany, when you said I'm from Palestine, they don't know where is Palestine. They said always Israel, but I can't say Israel because it's not Israel, it's Palestine.
How will it be in this front line here if the Syrians do advance? What will that be like? Do you think in reality that if they decide to come through here, you can stop them?
Well, not with our weapons, then with other bodies. And we will stop them, because we have decided to stop them and stop everyone who was trying to stop our revolution. That's our aid, the revolution till victory, and we'll try with whole our force to continue that way. And nobody can stop us. Nobody.
A little down the road, the Palestinians face another foe on another flank, the Lebanese right, who occupy the village on the slopes opposite, half a mile away. A combined assault here from the Syrians and the Lebanese right would force the Palestinians out and open the way to Beirut. On the other side of the front line, there is confidence, almost jubilation. Six months ago, the right faced defeat, but was saved by Syria, whose intervention now gives these fighters the prospect of victory. These men form Lebanon's social and educational elite, and they are consumed by a deep hatred. Hatred for the left, and hatred for the Palestinians, who almost brought an end to the Lebanon over which these fighters had held effortless sway. After months of fighting here, they wait to launch a major assault, listening for the word from Syria that her tanks are about to attack the Palestinians and drive on Beirut. How long would it take them, do you estimate, to get to Beirut from here?
Well, with their firepower and the equipment that they have, the tanks, and the number of men, I would estimate not longer than 72 hours.
Do you believe that the Syrians are bound to advance if they're going to achieve the military victory which you would like them to have?
It's not a question of military victory. We're not talking about military victories in Lebanon. We're talking about the reestablishment of peace and order. And the Syrians came in here with a static understanding with the Lebanese government that using their strength, they will reestablish normal life, peace and order in this country, and this is their objective.
And to establish that?
And to establish that, of course, you have to clean out all the muck and rubbish that exists around the places and, you know, have a clean country.
There has to be a final showdown, is what you're saying?
No doubt about it.
And you believe that you have to crush the Palestinian command?
We want to disintegrate it completely.
Danny, as we finished talking and there was suddenly that mass, is that the kind of fighting that's going on here now all the
time? Yes, very sporadic. Somebody probably puts their head above a bunker or something and they try and get them. It's the same on the other side.
And they fire into here in return?
Well, they will lob a few mortars. If you stick around here, you'll get a few on your head, so you better move out.
I think we'll move out in that case. Okay. The most formidable leader of the right is 76-year-old Kamil Shamoun, a past president of the Lebanon. Shamoun expects the Syrians to impose a final solution.
I'm very severe with the Palestinians because I don't want a repetition of what has happened during these last 18 months. I want this nonsense to be stopped once and for all. That's why I'm very severe with the Palestinians. They have to respect our laws and our regulations and our way of life and economy and not to indulge in any move, in any action, which might harm Lebanon, who has been very hospitable to them. As long as they do that, they are welcome. And if they want to behave the way they have been behaving during the past years, well, I prefer to see this war going on for six more months or for 1 year more than to have it repeated 2 or 3 years again.
The Palestinians must, in effect, become refugees again. Is that right?
They have to behave only as refugees. they have been here as refugees, and they should stay in Lebanon as refugees.
But what is it to be a refugee? Each day, for much of the day, the battle rages in Beirut. Here, on the edge of the city, there is some calm, but no peace. For this is Talazata, the refugee camp where the right avenged its hatred of the Palestinians. Those who fled Talazata, who were permitted to escape, are now on the other side. Here, they join the tens of scores of thousands of other refugees from the war. The people of Talazata have not forgotten what happened there. They press around you, want you to know every detail. Still in shock, near hysteria, they speak of the siege, of the hunger and the thirst, of the constant rockets and mortars, of babies who starved and died, of infants taken from mothers and murdered, of boys mutilated and shot, of entire families wiped out by shells, of a terrible atrocity. Nor are they yet safe. After the vengeance of the right, they now face the assault of Syria. The Syrian army doesn't need to advance directly on Beirut. Its tanks and artillery are also massed in the mountains, only 12 miles from the Palestinian supply route into the port of Sidon. A Syrian advance on Sidon would cut off the port and impose a blockade on Beirut, driving the Palestinians towards surrender or starvation. Four days ago, on the southern front line at Rum, the Palestinian command waited for the Syrian advance, knowing that no one, not even Syria's foes, would come to their defence. By then it was plain that Syrian tanks would seek the solution, not politicians. The Syrian army was dug in a mile away on the high ground. Syria's purpose is to destroy the leadership of the Palestinian movement in the Lebanon, to force its fighters to accept defeat. It was a tense, exposed, and dangerous front line.
When do you expect them to launch their attack?
Any minute.
Really?
Maybe now, maybe after an hour, maybe tomorrow, maybe after tomorrow.
Do you expect to receive heavy losses in their advance?
Our losses will be less than theirs, but we believe that in any fight between the Palestinians and Syrians, between the resistance movement and the Syrians, is a loss for both of us. We won't be happy if we defeat them. We wish if they would join us against our common enemy.
Which is Israel.
But we have to defend ourselves. We have to fight. They gave us no choice. We have to fight. Unfortunately, we have to fight against them.
Yesterday, the Syrians overran this front line. The Palestinians retreated before them to await the thrust on Sidon, 12 miles away down this road. In a refugee camp on the outskirts of Sidon, within range of the Syrian tanks, the children of Palestine train for the final battle. They are in earnest. No Palestinian enjoys sending children to war, but they believe it's necessary if they're ever to recapture the state from which they fled nearly 30 years ago and which then became Israel. These children learn to fight, to fire guns, and to kill for their cause. Within a few days, some of them will be fighting on the front. Some of them will die, but their cause won't. For unless you exterminate them, the parents, the children, and the children's children will never forget, will still want to go home.
It's a matter of living in your own country. Even if you live in a tent in your own country, you are not homeless. To Palestinians, it doesn't matter whether they are living in refugee camps or not. Most of the fighters could afford living in houses, but even we live in palaces. Still, we are homeless, we are stateless. One needs a home, one needs a state. It's horrible to look at the map of the world and find no place to say it's your own.
If the movement is suppressed here again, or the containment of the movement succeeds, will the consequence of that be much more individual, isolated acts of hijackings, things like that?
Well, if you corner a lovely, calm cat, it would turn into a tiger and it would scratch you and even kill you. It's not the cat's fault. Has the world left us any other choice than fighting? And we want to ask the world, is there anything for Palestinians? Is there anything to give us? I assure you, they give us nothing. Just words, words, words. Until they give us something. Until they give us the right to go back to our country. We will go on fighting and fighting and fighting, unfortunately.
The Palestinians are in their present plight because the battle they seem to be fighting in the Lebanon is in reality an international struggle for power in the Middle East, especially for the territories occupied by Israel in the 1967 war, and in particular for the West Bank. Israel, obviously, wants to destroy the Palestinian leadership, the PLO. So Prime Minister Rabin secretly provides tanks, guns, and training to the Lebanese right-wing militia. America approves Israel's action and also supports Israel's enemy, the Syrians, in their military assault on the Palestinians. Syria seeks to prevent upheaval in the Lebanon. She also seeks to be the most powerful Arab voice in any Middle East settlement.
From the very first day we took up arms, people have been conspiring against us, mostly Arabs. Many of our young men have died at Arab hands in Jordan and in Lebanon. Our losses there have been much greater than those inflicted by the Israeli enemy. But this is the way it has always been, because Arab states want to contain us and to impose their will on us.
Can you really imagine in the next few days a political solution which implies the destruction of the Palestinian leadership in the Lebanon?
Well, I think it will be much wiser, much better for the future if we eradicate this leadership. Because the change of leadership might mean, and will mean, the change of policy from the Palestinians, and will perhaps will help much more to a final settlement. Waging war is no use, and I don't think that we are going to accept in the future that any war can be waged from Lebanon, from the Lebanon borders, because this and the past experience has proved it, this will prove disastrous for Lebanon.
What you're saying is, am I right, that you have to have the total surrender of the Palestinians?
We are asking the Palestinians to stay quiet if they want to remain in Lebanon, to stay quiet in Lebanon.
We cannot accept an agreement which limits us in that way, because there is no point in our being in any place unless we can use our arms to support the struggle inside Israel. We certainly wouldn't accept that.
Do you believe that as a result of the war that's now been fought here, that you are further away from achieving your goal, which is a return to Palestine, Israel?
We're still optimistic. Our generation is the one which started the military struggle, and this will carry on even if our generation fails, as a new generation will grow up to continue the battle. I'm sure that one day we will return to our homes, because our cause is just.
Watched by most of the rest of the world with approval, the Syrians today seem ready to try and impose the final solution. If they succeed, the war in the Lebanon will soon end. But the anguish of the people of Palestine will go on, and the world will not be allowed to forget it.